Thank you very much. Welcome to our lecture of opportunity here today that we have a great opportunity to bring someone up from Washington, D.C., whose home is actually in Japan. And it was a great chance to be able to bring him up for a talk for my Korea elective, but also to be able to have him speak to the larger audience here. And so it is my great pleasure to introduce to you Narushige Michishita, who is a professor at the National Graduate Institute for Policy Studies in Tokyo. He is the director of the Security and International Studies program there and one of Japan's top scholars on North Korea. He is currently a visiting research fellow at the Woodrow Wilson Center's Asia program in Washington, D.C., and previously served as a senior research fellow at Japan's National Institute for Defense Studies, or affectionately known as NIDS. He also has extensive service in government as Deputy Director of the Office of Strategic Studies at the Ministry of Defense and as the Assistant Counselor at the Cabinet Secretary for Security and Crisis Management. He is a specialist in Japanese security and foreign policy, as well as security issues on the Korean Peninsula, and has a very long list of publications. One of my favorites, if you're interested in a book that he wrote, is called North Korea's Military Diplomatic Campaigns, 1968 to 2008. It is a wonderful book that walks through that historical record of how North Korea has tried to use brinkmanship to advance its goals, and I think you will see that a good deal of that reflected in his talk. Many people look at North Korea and see and focus on the last maybe 5 to 10 years of its provocative behavior. They have been doing some of those things many, many years prior to that, and you will see a great presentation from Dr. Michi on that. He is a regular commentator in many media sources on a variety of topics related to Japan and Korea. He did his PhD at Johns Hopkins University in international relations and is fluent in Korean and English. And today, again, he will address the history of North Korean brinksmanship. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Michi.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Terry, for your kind invitation and introduction. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming. Today, I'm going to talk about the history of North Korea's brinkmanship diplomacy based on the book, the study that I did that Terry so kindly mentioned. I'm going to do three things. One is, first, I will give you the kind of findings of my research based on the history, and I'll briefly go take you through the history of North Korea's use of force from 1966 up to the present. And finally, I'll talk a little bit about future outlook. First, major findings. I have actually five findings and one no finding. First finding is that North Korea's policy objectives have changed in using force, have changed from highly ambitious and offensive ones to minimum or defensive ones. Two, North Korea's use of force was successful in some cases in which they used force, but unsuccessful in others, yet in other cases it produced disastrous negative results to North Korea. Three, North Korea's use of force has reflected its changing policy objectives and military balance. In that sense, North Korean use of force has been rational and well calculated. And North Korea's use, the modality of its use of force have changed as military balance have shifted against North Korea since the mid-1970s in favor of South Korea and the U.S. side. Four, some of North Korea's recent actions are repetition of past actions with tactical changes. I'll talk about the reason why they're doing so. And finally, some of the North Korean actions caused the US ROK side, ROK being Republic of Korea, to take countermeasures, compromising North Korea's military advantages over time. And lastly, one no finding is that it is not clear at this point whether Kim Jong-un, the new leader in his early 30s, will play the same game of brinkmanship diplomacy going forward. Let me move to the history, the second part. There are five phases in which North Korea used force in different ways. The first phase covers the years between 1966 and 1972, in which North Korea started to use force aggressively. And I named this era genesis of North Korea's military diplomatic campaigns. And second era covers the years between 1973 and 1982, in which North Korea started to use force for diplomatic purposes. Well-coordinated military diplomatic campaigns really started. The third phase, which lasted between 1983 and 1992, we saw during this phase the rise of use of terrorist attacks. And the fourth phase covers years between 1993 and 2008, in which North Korea conducted very elaborate, sophisticated brinkmanship diplomacy using mainly its nuclear and missile capabilities. And finally, the fifth phase is Kim Jong-un era, which started in 2009 as a practical matter, although he came to power officially in 2012. So I'll walk you through these different phases one by one, talking about what happened, what the North Koreans did, what was objectives, and how successful and unsuccessful some of their actions were, characteristics of the actions, and negative consequences of their actions, if any. First, let me show the slide. Genesis of military diplomatic campaigns. Between 1966 and 69, North Korea conducted sustained assaults on USROK forces along the DMZ, which were concentrated in these areas. And then in 1968, North Korean Special Operation Forces attempted an raid on the Blue House, South Korean Presidential Palace, in order to assassinate then President Park Chung-hee, current President Park Geun-hye's father. And in the same year, in January, just two days after this attempted assassination of President Park, North Korea captured U.S. ship Pueblo east coast of North Korea, off the port of Wonsan. This is photos of Pueblo, USS Pueblo. By the way, USS Pueblo is currently anchored in Taedong River in Pyongyang, as a museum, anti-imperial, movement or fight museum. So if you are interested, you might want to visit to take a look at the USS Pueblo. In 1969, North Korea shut down US Navy EC-121 intelligence gathering aircraft and successfully, and killing all the members, U.S. Navy members on board. In 1970, North Korea attempted to assassinate again President Park Chung-hee of South Korea when he was going to make a speech at the National Theater, but failed. What were the objectives and outcome of these actions? First objective that North Korea had was to overthrow the South Korean government. But so in order to do so, they tried to assassinate President Park, but their attempt failed. The second was objective was to hamper U.S. intelligence activities. In order to do so, they captured Pueblo, shut down U.S. EC-121 successfully. And this was really successful because they, North Korea, not only captured Pueblo, but captured some of the important intelligence documents. Well, they certainly, people on board tried to dump it as much as possible before they got captured, but still they couldn't do, perfectly successfully. So they obtained some documents. They combined them with the intelligence information that they had, I mean, the Soviet Union had, and or combined them with intelligence information that John Walker was providing to the Soviets, and the Soviets could use them to identify the whereabouts of U.S. Naval vessels. Third objective was to divert USROK attention away from the Vietnam War, because back then both the United States and South Korea forces were fighting in Vietnam, and North Korea, as a part of international assistance to the Northern Vietnamese communist friends, tried to divert US and South Korean attention and kind of by opening a second front on the Korean Peninsula. And it was reasonably successful in the sense that although North Korea could not prevent the U.S., both the U.S. and South Korean forces from continuing their fights in Vietnam, they could successfully prevent the reinforcement of South Korean forces committed to the Vietnam War. Before these attempts, President Park was thinking about reinforcing or adding some forces to Vietnam after crisis, tensions arose on the Korean Peninsula. President Park reversed his decision. So what can we say? During this period, North Korea's objectives in using force were extremely ambitious and aggressive and very successful. Characteristics of the use of force was aggressive, direct application of force, and also some use of coercive, subversive, subversive use of force. There were negative consequences to what they did, because when North Korea started to attack U.S. and South Korean forces across the DMZ, demilitarized zone, the USROK side decided to fortify the DMZ zone, the area, and so it became difficult for North Korea and special operation forces to infiltrate into the southern side after that. And that was partly why North Korea started to dig tunnels underneath the DMZ from early 1970s. And also, South Korea decided to establish 2 million man homeland reserve forces. And also, there was South Korea embarked on construction of indigenous defense industry, namely Pohang Iron and Steel Company, which today is called POSCO. Let me move to the second phase, in which North Korea used force for a limited way for diplomatic purposes. In 1973, North Korea started to send its naval vessels across the quasi borderline between the north and south, called the Northern Limit Line, or NLL, in order to basically undermine the validity of this line, Northern Limit Line, which was unilaterally drawn by the United Nations Command in 1953, just after the end of the Korean War. And it was interesting because North Korea started to send vessels in October 1973, just 2 months before the conference on conference on UN's Law of the Sea was held in New York. So North Koreans apparently knew that something new was going to happen in the discussion and the discourse on the international law, maritime law, and started to make their case by having their ship crossing this NLL line. And also during this period, North Korea started to propose, for the first time, a signing of a peace agreement with the United States. By the way, even today, technically speaking, the Korean War has not ended. It's just had the armistice. So the war is technically or legally still ongoing, but the fighting has ceased. And the North Koreans are telling the Americans to sign a peace agreement and to replace the armistice agreement of 1953 with it. Again, in 1974, North Korean operative attempted to assassinate Park Chung-hee, President Park, but failed, and instead, in the gunfight between the assassin and the South Korean guards, President First Lady Yoo Kyung-soo, President Park's wife, got shot and killed. In 1976, there was another interesting incident in a place called the Joint Security Area in Panmunjom, which is on the borderline between the north and the south, and there, in which two of American Army, U.S. Army officers were killed brutally by axes that North Korean soldiers were wielding, and that created the international crisis. After this event, the U.S. deployed a large number of air and sea forces and decided to actually cut the poplar tree, which kind of became the starting point of this incident. In 1981, North Korea attempted to attack U.S. reconnaissance aircraft SR-71. So what are the objectives and outcome? First of all, North Korea attempted by sending ships across the northern limit line, tried to make maritime territorial claims and in order to undermine the legal or validity of the line. It was moderately successful because North Korea could not enforce what they were claiming. But at least they could kind of create a situation where there are debate about the nature and legal standing of the northern limit line. Two, North Korea tried to conclude a peace agreement with the United States, and actually North Korea was asked Romania, countries like Romania, to tell. Convey their its intention to sign a peace agreement with the U.S. to the U.S. government, and people like Henry Kissinger was kind of quite interested and thought about doing so, although in the end he decided not to. And also North Korea tried to encourage the United States to withdraw its forces deployed in South Korea by, for example, attacking U.S. officers at Panmunjom. And the message basically was like, if you try, keep your young, American boys or officers on the Korean Peninsula, this is what's going to happen. So if you don't like to get, you know, bogged down in Korea as the United States did in Vietnam, the U.S. forces should be withdrawn. And also, fourth, North Korea continue to attempt hampering U.S. intelligence activities, but not too successfully. They failed to. They actually launched SA-2 surface-to-air missile at SR-71, but missed it. And another attempt was made to assassinate South Korean president, but it failed. So what we can say about this phase is that North Korea's policy objectives was not as grandiose as those in the 1960s, but still quite ambitious, such as forcing the U.S. to withdraw its forces from South Korea or undermining the South Korean government. Another interesting new element that we can see in this period was that the emergence of cooperative objective, because in the previous phase, the U.S. North Korea was basically attacking both South Korea and U.S. forces, but now while attacking some U.S. forces, North Korea started to talk about enhancing its relationship with the United States. Overall, North Korean attempt was not very successful. In particular, the axe murder incident, tree-cutting incident of 1976 was disastrously unsuccessful, undermining North Korea's international position, because international community could easily see how brutal North Korea could be, and it really undermined North Korean position. Characteristics of use of force, North Korean use of force during this period. The use of force was conducted in a limited and indirect manner, unlike the previous period in which North Koreans are really attacking and killing a large number of South Korea and U.S. Servicemen. And if you can take a look at this, these are the numbers of U.S. casualties, killed and wounded, and ROK South Korean casualties, and death and wounded, killed and wounded. But you could see a substantial reduction of these numbers in the 1970s. And also another thing, interesting fact, is that while creating a large number of deaths on the U.S. and ROK side, they were taking a pretty significant casualties on their side, North Korean side. So they are not creating a lot of mess on the U.S. ROK side. They were taking some heat. So it was not a one-sided game that they were playing. North Korea was using force coercively in an indirect manner, and military actions was taken to exploit international legal development, such as United Nations Conference on Law of the Sea. And also interestingly, attempted attack against the U.S. SR-71 in 1981 was the last direct use of force against North Korea's direct use of force against U.S. personnel and or assets. Since then, they make all the, use bad languages, hostile, aggressive language it was at the United States, but never have attempted to kill or harm U.S. forces and assets. That's quite interesting. There are several negative consequences resulting from North Korea's provocations. First, South Korea, faced with infiltration of a large number of North Korean naval forces coming across the NLL, South Korea decided to build up on its own naval capabilities. And that eventually resulted in, I will talk about it later, but in a one-sided decisive victory of South Korean Navy against over the North Korean Navy in 1999 battle in the Yellow Sea. Second, South Korea decided to fortify its offshore islands. There are five these islands, Paenyeondo, Daechondo, Sochondo, Yeonpyeondo, and Udo. And these islands are hard to defend because they are more, you know, farther away from South Korea than from North Korea. But they decided to, like Taiwanese did to Jinmen and Mazu Islands, South Korea fortified these islands during this period. And also, South Korean government adopted what's called the Sasu strategy, which means that they would defend NLL no matter what, unconditionally, because they knew that there were some legal problems in enforcing this NLL, because ultimately it was a unilaterally declared line, but they decided, well, you know, we'll use force to defend this no matter what. Let me move to the third phase in which terrorism came to the fore. In 1983, North Korean operatives exploded the timed bomb, well, not timed bomb, remotely controlled bomb in a tomb of in, you know, the legendary general of Burma in the capital city Yangon, and now then called Rangoon, killing a number of South Korean cabinet members. Because President Chun Doo-hwan, South Korean President Chun Doo-hwan, was visiting Rangoon and failed to kill President himself. In 1987, North Korean two operatives set the timed bomb in a South Korean airline passenger aircraft flying from the Middle East back to Seoul, and exploded it in the air and killing all the passengers on board. North Korea's objectives during this period seem to have included one, assassination of South Korean president for obvious reasons, but it was disastrously failed. Why? Because they not only failed to kill the president, but also the fact that North Korean agent did the job was revealed, because some of the agents got arrested just after executing this operation. And second objective that North Korea had was to undermine successful convening of the Seoul Olympic Games in 1988. So that was probably why they exploded the bomb on the Korean airliner, to demonstrate to the world that the coming to Seoul can be pretty dangerous. But again, this was disastrously failed, because one of the two operatives, one male, one female, female one failed to kill herself. That actually, male agent committed the suicide. You know, took a you know, a pill, poisonous pill, and killed himself successfully. She failed. He took the pill, couldn't. And she survived, and eventually she made a confession that she was acting under North Korean authorities under the order of Kim Jong-il. And so that was really a big negative international you know, kind of revelation that North Korea was undertaking terrorist attacks. I would say these policy objectives that the North Korean had during the period came out of reflected North Korea's sense of desperation, because Back then, still North Korea and South Korea was competing on a relatively on an equal footing. But when these events happened and it was revealed that the North Koreans executed these terrorist attacks, it was clear that North Korea has lost in this competition for legitimacy on the Korean Peninsula. And South Korea, I would say, by the end of 1987, prevailed in this competition with North Korea. And so in that sense, in a way, I would say that North Korea's objective during this period was defensive one. Actions were aggressive and offensive, but intentions, because they are trying to prevent South Korea to achieve from achieving successes, international successes of convening Olympic Games in Seoul. Disastrous outcome and the characteristics during this period was a terrorist type subversive attempt with direct and indirect use of force. And interestingly, again, the Rangoon incident in Yangon, which took place in Burma, was the last subversive attempt on the part of North Korea against South Korean leadership. So since this time, North Korea, again, all the wars and attacks, verbal attacks targeted at the South Korean government, never have attempted to kill, assassinate South Korean president. Negative consequences of what North Korea did during this period was a designation by the U.S. government of North Korea as a terrorism sponsoring countries, which made life very difficult for the country. Let me move to the fourth stage. This is elaborate and sustained military diplomatic campaigns. Between 1993 and 94, North Korea conducted what I would call a first nuclear diplomacy, in which North Korea used its capacity and intention to produce nuclear weapons in order to lure the U.S. Into a negotiating table, and eventually in 1994 they signed the U.S.-North Korea agreed framework, in which North Korea promised to freeze its nuclear development while the United States decided to provide heavy fuel oil as well as a light water reactor to North Korea. Between 1998 and 2000, North Korea conducted this missile diplomacy using the development of a longer range ballistic missile, which North Korea launched for the first time in August 1998, which flew over Japan for the first time. And conducting this nuclear and missile diplomacy, North Korea was kind of playing a sideshow, which I would characterize as a campaign to undermine the Korean armistice, because they are again trying to take up the issue of NLL and other things. And North Korean vessels again started to cross the northern limit line. And the North Korean argument was this: okay, this northern limit line is illegal and not binding and invalid. But because South Korea tried to enforce this illegal line, clashes are inevitable, and wars might be created because of that. So if the U.S. and DPRK government sign a peace agreement replacing the armistice agreement and draw a new line based on the international law, such as UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, these clashes and the skirmishes and the wars will be prevented. That was North Korea's argument. Because in order to do so, North Korea again, in a systematic and continuous manner, started to send its vessels across the NLL to the north. But South Koreans really responded quite strongly, because by that time, North Korean Navy had a decisive superiority over the North Korean counterpart. And as a result, there was a big battle of Yeonpyeong taking place on June the 15th of 1999, in which South Korean vessels basically beat up on the North Korean counterpart. And by the way, one of the vessels involved in this battle was South Korean corvette Chonan. And interestingly, North Korea in 2002, let me talk a little bit about, in a surprise attack, sank one of South Korean fast boat called a Chamsuri, and which again was actually involved in the Battle of Yeonpyeong in 1999. So I would say this was the first attempt by North Korea to take a revenge for its defeat in 1999 naval battle. And then between 2002 and 2008, North Korea conducted the second round of nuclear diplomacy, during which time North Korea launched the first Tepodon II longer range ballistic missile, which failed in 2006, and also conducted the first nuclear test in October 2006, which was half success, half failure, because before the test, North Korea basically said there was going to be a 4 kiloton nuclear test. And when they did it, they achieved only less than 1 kiloton of explosion. So what we can say is that it was successful in the sense that bomb went off. It was not successful in the sense that it failed to achieve the expected explosion yield. What were the North Korea's objectives and outcomes? One of them was obtaining economic and energy assistance from the international community, which was fairly successful, because North Korea did succeeded in obtaining provision of 500,000 tons of heavy fuel oil after the signing of agreed framework in 1994. And it was obtaining this amount of heavy fuel oil annually until 2002. And they failed to obtain a light water reactor because light water reactor was under construction, well under construction, based on the 1994 agreed framework. But when it was revealed that North Korea was constructing a secret uranium-based nuclear program in 2002, the provision of the light water reactor was frozen. So they were still sitting half-constructed in North Korea. North Korea also tried to normalize relations with the United States and Japan, and it could have been more successful, because toward the end of 2000, then President Clinton was thinking of visiting Pyongyang to improve U.S. relationship with North Korea, but decided not to, because he was choosing between, addressing the Middle East peace process or its normalization process with North Korea, and he chose the Middle East. And also, Japanese Prime Minister Koizumi visited North Korea in 2002 in an attempt to normalize relations with the North Korea. And the Japanese government was suggesting a package deal in which North Korea would address nuclear missile and Japanese abductees issue, while Japan would normalize relations with diplomatic relations with North Korea and provide a pretty significant economic assistance package ranging between $5 to $10 billion if it happens. But never successfully, it didn't succeed, and the normalization process failed. And North Korea tried to pursue a peace agreement with the U.S., but unsuccessfully. During this period, North Korea's policy objectives were minimalist in the sense that its most important objective was regime survival. It was not talking about overthrowing South Korean government anymore. It was not talking about forcing the U.S. To withdraw its forces from South Korea. So it was not talking about, out-compete South Korea anymore. It was the survival was the key. So North Korean actions were defensive in nature, and I would say moderately successful. But there were negative consequences. For example, because North Korea repeatedly engaged in the development of nuclear weapons and even conducted the test, economic sanctions or financial sanctions were imposed on the country. And also, because North Korea conducted the actual nuclear test, plausible deniability of them not possess coming up with actual nuclear weapon was gone. So before the first nuclear test, we could kind of argue, well, North Korea might have nuclear weapons, but might not. Therefore, we might be able to come up with some kind of diplomatic deal in which North Korea decide to freeze the development while we provide some assistance or improve relations with the country. But now they have clearly possessed nuclear weapons. It would be very difficult for a government such as Japanese and the US government, South Korean government, to say that we should normalize relations with North Korea. Finally, last phase, Kim Jong-un era from 2009. Why 2009? Because in the summer of 2008, Kim Jong-un suffered a stroke, and he got basically ill and hospitalized for a while. And when he came back, he decided, in a way, he was pretty responsible and kind of thoughtful leader in that sense, because he realized that his days were numbered. And he had to undertake power transition process as soon as possible, and he did. It's kind of difficult, psychologically difficult for somebody to implement a policy, set of policies based on the assumption that he will or she will die soon, right? But he did, interesting. And he picked Kim Jong-un as his successor and started the process. And in 2009, as a part of, I would say, as a part of this process, North Korea launched another long-range missile, what we call Tepodon 2 and what they call Una 2, quite successfully. It flew more than 3,000 kilometers and impacted in the West Pacific Ocean. And North Korea then conducted the second nuclear test in the same, more or less in the same area in the eastern coast of North Korea in the underground test site, second test, which achieved a few kilotons of explosion yield, which was better than the first one. And I would say, because the first one was not too successful, North Korea must have used more or less the same device in the same test, and it achieved 2-3 when they were talking about 4 kilotons of explosion. It was quite successful. And then in 2010, North Korea undertook two very provocative actions. One was the sinking of a South Korean corvette named Chonan in the Yellow Sea, and also shelling, North Korea shelled the offshore, South Korea's offshore island named Yeonpyeong, killing 46 people, South Korean sailors in the case of Chonan, and the 4 South Korean citizens in the case of shelling of Yeonpyeong Island. In 2012, North Korea launched a longer range ballistic missile, what they called UNA 3, twice. One failed, the other succeeded. And they even succeeded in putting a satellite into orbit, and actually this satellite is still rotating around the globe. And also in 2013, North Korea conducted its third nuclear test, which achieved several kilotons. And this is a pretty bad kind of ominous development, because and after the test, North Korean authority declared that they used a more powerful and lighter and smaller version of atomic bomb. That means that the device probably was miniaturized. So as a result, our estimate is that now North Korea will probably be able to, is able to kind of mate nuclear weapons with at least medium range ballistic missiles such as Nodong, which can attack Japan. And in 2014, there was another interesting development in which North Korea launched 2 Nodong missiles from northwestern part of North Korea into the Sea of Japan, which was new, because in the past North Korea was launching these missiles from the east coast of North Korea. But now they are launching them from a deeper inside its territory. That means it would be very difficult for Japan to take on these missiles before they get launched. So I would say the pattern of their missile launching is becoming more realistic and operational. And in this year, North Korea started, it froze the operation of a 5-megawatt reactor, nuclear reactor, in northwestern part of North Korea called Nyeonbyeong in 2007, but now it resumed the operation, and I don't know what the country is trying to do with that. There seems to be 4 likely objectives that North Korea has in doing this and that in the recent years. One is certainly to consolidate Kim Jong-un's domestic position. It seems to be quite successful in the sense that he is still there, and he's keep promoting and demoting some of his close aides at will. And 2 is certainly to enhance its strategic military capabilities, such as longer range missiles, ballistic missiles, and nuclear forces. And it's been quite successful. And the 3rd one was to take a revenge for earlier South Korean actions, which namely the 1999 victory, one-sided victory of South Korea over North Korea in the Battle of Yeonpyeong. And and the 4th objective would be to normalize relations with the US and Japan, because Japan and North Korea are still engaged in dialogue, and you know, the Japanese government is telling North Korea to address the issue of abductees, but North Korea is not really forthcoming, unfortunately. And North Korea is telling the Americans to come back to the table to discuss normalization or improvement of relations, but the U.S. government is not forthcoming. So it's not going anywhere, but North Korea is still trying. But North Korea's actions during this period have been quite not necessarily focused on diplomatic diplomacy. Certainly North Korea seems to be trying to improve its relationship with Japan and the U.S. Possibly. Their focus still seems to be on largely on domestic issues. And so the characteristics of North Korean actions is that it's kind of interesting that they've been testing different assets, such as, you know, longer-range ballistic missiles, nuclear weapons, you know, submarine-launched ballistic missiles, and new multiple rocket launchers and things like that. So it's quite diverse and interesting. And North Korea seems to be really serious in developing its nuclear and missile capabilities. And it was quite impressive to me when North Korea decided to launch a longer range ballistic missile just before April the 15th of 2012, which was the 100th anniversary of Kim Il-sung, who is the founder of North Korea. His birthday. So it was, you know, North Korea is gearing up to celebrate this 100th anniversary. So the failure was not an option, right, politically. But still, North Korea decided to go ahead and launch this missile, which it was testing kind of for the first time. So it failed as a result, but I was quite impressed how determined North Korean leaders were to develop longer-range ballistic missiles. And so my, you know, kind of question that I have right now is whether and when North Korea might be coming back to a more traditional Brinkmanship diplomacy that we are seeing during Kim Jong-il's era. We don't know. There are kind of signs. They talk about, you know, peace agreement. They talk about, you know, they have resumed operation of 5 megawatt reactors. But, you know, partly because the U.S. is not reacting very positively, North Korean attempt seems to be going nowhere. Finally, let me talk a little bit about future prospect. Let me skip some things. North Korea is playing the same game, but now an interesting change is taking place, which is North Korea's relationship with China seems to be kind of undergoing some changes. And also, under a new leader, it's kind of trying to come up with a new way of handling things, both domestically and internationally. So we have to, you know, we are kind of keeping eyes on what North Korea is up to. But in terms of the policy options that we have, I think we have two policy options. Neither of them is attractive, but we have to pick one. And the one is, I would say, neglect policy, benign neglect policy, or what, you know, the U.S. government calls it a strategic patience strategy. And there is an upside and downside. Positive side is that this policy option is cheap because we are doing nothing, basically ignoring North Korea, so it's not expensive. And also may best encourage North Korea's open-door reformist policy because, I mean, you know, left to its own devices. They have to find their own way to change the situation and improve the situation. So they cannot rely on outside assistance. You know, they, a lot of assistance was coming from South Korea under Kim Dae-jung administration and the Norman Hill administration. It's not coming anymore. Downside of this approach is that North Korea will continue to develop nuclear and missile capabilities, and actually may allow this kind of strategy may allow North Korea to go under the Chinese, expanding Chinese sphere of influence. Another choice is engagement policy, and the upside of it is that it might be able to freeze or delay the North Korea's nuclear and missile development. And although early dismantlement of these programs is not realistic. And this kind of policy will be able to maintain influence because we are to engage with North Korea over and interactions with the North Korean leadership, which can be useful in case North Korea collapsed or something bad happened in North Korea. Downside of this policy is that it's going to be quite costly because they are not going to do good things free of charge. We have to do something, you know, pay something. And involves moral hazard and hard, that kind of policy will be hard to obtain popular support in the United States, South Korea, or in Japan. That's it. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Concerning the two, the old man and the lady and the blowing up of the airline, and no, at that time there was talk that they were pretending to be Japanese, mm-hmm. and that she had actually been taught Japanese culture by some of the abductees,
yeah.
from Japan, rather. Was that substantiated at all?
I think so, because when it happened, we asked the North Korean government to confirm, it's asked about this. North Koreans denied it, that there was no such a person. But then in 2002, when Prime Minister Koizumi visited Pyongyang, they acknowledged that there was that person who taught Japanese to Kim Hyung-hee, who was North Korean operative. Was there, has been kidnapped, although she was dead by then. But we don't know whether she was really dead or not, so we are still asking.
The abduction issue is an interesting one. North Korea has admitted to it, so it's not like they are still denying that they have done it. And so I'm wondering what your assessment is of why the North Koreans continue to be reluctant to mm-hmm. have a full accounting of that to improve its relationship with Japan, perhaps presumably to receive some economic aid in finally settling it. Or in fact, do the North Koreans really have no interest in settling this in that they have more to gain by maintaining a hostile relationship domestically with Japan and try to work this issue? I'm curious what your thoughts are on North Korea's motivation about the abduction issue in regards to settling it.
I think, at least in 2002, North Korean government was very, very interested in normalizing relations with Japan, because before Mr. Koizumi's visit, people are saying, even specialists were saying, no way. I mean, North Korea would not acknowledge the abduction of Japanese citizens. But it did. And the Kim Jong-il himself said, I'm sorry, right? Why? Because he was interested in this money, you know, big economic assistance package coming from Japan. So that's why he acknowledged it and even returned five of abductees, 15, then 15 abductees officially designated as a, you know, by the Japanese government as North Korea abductees. But then North Korea said, well, others were dead for, you know, according to them, for various but kind of strange reasons. Traffic accident, gas accident, you know, drowning in the sea. So it's like not really, things that don't happen very often in your life, you know, so it's like really. And so why? Because, well, maybe some of them are dead, but some others might be alive. But there must be some reasons why North Korea cannot produce them. And my guess is, this is my personal guess, I might be wrong, but North Korea might have used some of them as a part of their espionage activities. Therefore, some of them, if that's the case, could have been exposed to very sensitive espionage activities which North Korea would never allow to be revealed to the outside world. Then that might be making it difficult for them to return them. And so I don't know. That's my guess, but we'll see.
You mentioned the change in relationship between the DPRK and the Chinese governments. How is that changing, and what interests does China have, not only in the containment but the preservation?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think China is trying to strike a good balance between preventing North Korea from taking further provocative destabilizing actions, such as developing nuclear and missile capabilities, and taking hostile provocative military actions against South Korea or the United States, and maintaining the stability on the Korean Peninsula, that means that stable North Korean government, right, and a stable North Korean society. So it seems that while putting pressure on North Korea by kind of treating the new leadership in a kind of offhanded manner and a pretty unfriendly manner, China seems to be continue to provide necessary assistance to the country by, you know, means of pipelines, you know, providing oil and other things, energy, food. So it is trying to maintain a good balance. And now that the U.S. Sino-U.S. relationship has become a little bit more tense than before, there are signals or signs that China might be trying to enhance its relationship with North Korea in order to put further pressure on the U.S., South Korea, and Japan. So we'll see.
Please. You mentioned that the two policy options with respect to North Korea, one of neglect, the other of engagement, and in terms of neglect, that might create a condition where China can influence North Korea. How do you see, if the U.S. chooses an engagement policy, how China would respond to that if the United States became more engaged?
Mm. Well, China is not necessarily opposed to U.S. and South Korea or even Japanese engagement with North Korea. Why? Because China would like to see stable North Korea, right? And if other countries are willing to contribute to the effort to maintain stability on the Korean Peninsula, China would welcome it. So it's not necessarily a bad thing. But from our perspective, it can be a bad thing that North Korea falls into under the influence of China too much. One example I would raise here in this context is the fact that in 2009, I think, Chinese vessels, naval vessels, visited, made a port call to Wonsan after, I would say, 20 years or so. So it was, and also North Korea, China has come up with a contract with the North Korean government to use so that Chinese commercial companies and can use the North Korean port in Najin, which is in the north eastern part of North Korea, for a long time. So if this continued, my worry is that North Korea might end up allowing China to use a part of its country for military purposes, namely some of the ports in facing the Sea of Japan. I don't know, but I don't think it's a good idea for us to kind of make it, create a permissive environment in which it might happen. So I would like to take, if I'm in charge, I would like to take kind of preventive measures so that this, I don't know whether how likely this is, but this will never happen. Because if China start using North Korean ports in the Sea of Japan, that would really complicate our military situation for our defense requirements.
Just if you would permit me a follow-up, if the U.S., Japan, and South Korea engaged as well as China, do you think that their objectives and interests would intersect in terms of denuclearization, or would we have converging interests and objectives? And I guess the way I see it, how does that play out in terms of stability?
Well, I mean, I would say realistically, denuclearization is not a realistic policy goal. And so it's kind of, to me, it's unfortunate that while we keep talking about denuclearization and we kind of stick to this policy goal, North Korea just keep developing its, nuclear and missile capabilities. So it's like, is it working? So I would like to see the governments of in Washington, Seoul, Japan to become a little bit more realistic and start pursuing achievable goals. That would, is more likely to produce better results. That's my thought. Any other question, please?
When you look back at the events of the 60s, 70s, and 80s, North Korea did some fairly nasty things to South Korea and the United mm-hmm. States, and yet there was not much of a response militarily that you might have expected some sort of strikes from South Korea and the United States. Of course, the reason because folks concerned about starting a larger war.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if you could talk a little bit to what you think the North Korean assessment of those facts were. Conducting those operations were not risk-free by the North Koreans, and they certainly mm-hmm. had to be taking risks to conduct some of those. Were they, to what degree did they believe that they would not get a response based on history, and did that figure into their calculations to be perhaps a bit more gutsy in what they did because they felt fairly confident they mm-hmm. wouldn't get a response, mm-hmm. or did they not necessarily think in those terms in regards mm-hmm. to their risk calculations?
Mm-hmm. Well, several things. One, South Koreans did not necessarily not respond. Actually, toward the end of the 1960s, South Koreans were sending secretly. They didn't tell the American friends special operation forces into North Korea and undertaking some disruptive activities, such as they were sending special operation forces to basically blow up North Korean Army Division headquarters. with impunity and without any taking casualties. And so now there are kind of retired officers coming out and in South Korea telling what they were doing, and they were basically bragging about this. But so that was what they did. But I mean, after a while, the U.S. side Americans found out that what the South Koreans were doing, and get pretty concerned because that might, as you said, escalate this, you know, that this kind of activities might end in wars, major wars. So Americans were saying, no, don't use take a punitive response. Rather, we have to take a defensive response, which was about basically strengthening the defense of DMZ. And so the fences, better fences were constructed. Three-layer defensive systems were constructed, you know, quick response forces deployed, and all that. And that was pretty, I would say, stabilizing and successful military response. And North Korean, and also North Koreans are basically thinking, North Korea really embarked on a major military build-up effort in 1962. Just after the Cuban Missile Crisis, because they realized that these, you know, communist big brothers might not be too reliable. So after, you know, seven, eight years, North Korean military was very strong. So they were confident that even if there was another war, they can at least defend themselves and maybe win the war. So military balance was there. And also, you know, North Korean leaders clearly knew what was going on in Vietnam. You know, there was no willingness in the US or in South Korea to, you know, start another war on the Korean Peninsula. So North Koreans were based, you know, backed up by this military force and by international environment, was very confident that whatever they do, the U.S. Would not take a really strong response.
Okay, please. So you talked about they were on the state-sponsored list for terrorism, and then of course State Department took them off. I mean, do you feel any other reasons why they? I mean, you really haven't heard from them that much in the last couple of years, and have they exported other, I mean, as far as, you know, other means with other countries, or, you know, if you could elaborate on that?
Yeah.
I mean, it seems like they've been kind of quiet.
Sure. Yeah. Well, I mean, another major activities that they were in the North Korea was engaged in was providing assistance to National People's Army in the Philippines. And it was going on for quite some time, although they stopped it. And now I could say that, you know, partly because terrorist attempt failed disastrously, they learned lessons, right? And it was Kim Jong-il who did the job, you know, both Rangoon bombing and bombing of Korean airliner. And she learned lessons and paid the price. She started to play a pretty sophisticated Brinkmanship diplomacy from the 1990s, but you have to understand how he learned and had learned lessons in the previous decade. So that's one. And also, I would say this policy, changing policy objective was very important, because now in order to enhance relationship with the United States, I mean, getting off the list of terrorists sponsoring state was, requirement, right, for them. And the Bush administration, George W. Bush administration, toward the end of its term in 2008, decided to delist North Korea as a terrorism sponsoring country. And so it was, North Koreans succeeded in convincing by not engaging international terrorism activities that convinced the U.S. to delist it. So it was, in that sense, successful. So now the, very basic step toward improved U.S. DPRK relations has been taken. It has been paved. Anything else?
Let me ask one last question, and we'll go off script just a little bit, since we have the opportunity here to have a top-flight Japanese security policy expert here as well. To ask you if you would just take a few minutes to comment on the recent changes in Japanese security policy, collective self-defense, and some of the things that Prime Minister Abe has done. Would be interested in your thoughts as perhaps a closing.
Okay, sure. Let me talk a little bit about what it means to the security on the Korean Peninsula. Before the change, let me talk about several things that Japan's self-defense force can do now, which it couldn't before the change. One is that now self-defense force can protect U.S. vessels, U.S. military asset, operating for the defense of South Korea, even before Japan gets attacked, right? Because now Japan can exercise the right of collective self-defense. So it's a good news that we can start operating together from the early stages of crisis conflict. Second, the self-defense force could not shoot down missiles that North Korea launched, against Hawaii or Guam. If they launch missiles toward Hawaii, that will fly over northern part of Japan, like here. And also, if they launch missiles toward Guam, they will be flying like this. Before this change, the SDF, we have a pretty good ballistic missile defense capabilities, but was not able to shoot down, not technically necessary, but legally, could not shoot down these missiles. But we can now. But there is another separate technical issue because now that the SDF has two different BMD systems. One is SM-3 Block 1A, which is a sea-based extra atmospheric upper tier system. And the other is a land-based Patriot PAC-3. It's an endo-atmospheric lower tier missile system. But these missiles are not capable enough to take on kind of intermediate range missiles to be used against Hawaii or Guam. So even if we are now legally take on North Korean missiles flying toward Hawaii or Guam, we might not be able to do the job. But if we are now talking about introducing advanced sea-based ballistic BMD system called SM-3 Block 2A, which has a better velocity, accuracy, speed. And then if this system is deployed, then we'll be able to take on some of the missiles flying toward Hawaii and Guam. So then it will start, it starts to matter what we can do legally. And third, the self-defense force will now be able to conduct minesweeping operations, not only in the vicinity of Japan, but also in the waters very close to North Korea, and probably including North Korean territory waters. This is very important because in the final phases of the war, U.S. Marine Corps will be conducting amphibious landing operations, right? And clearing mines would be a necessity in order for the successful amphibious operation. So Japan will be taking up a very important role in this. But this has been causing some frictions between Japan and South Korea, because according to the South Korean constitution, North Korea, South Korea has a sovereignty over the North Korean territory, right? Which is just fictitious, but they say it. It says it. So South Korea is saying, Japan must obtain endorse approval by the South Korean government before it starts operating inside North Korean territories. But we disagree because we don't recognize sovereignty, South Korea's sovereignty over the North Korean territory. So there is a kind of discrepancy in our views, and we have to kind of, I think basically we have to play kabuki when it comes to the time when we have to do the job while maintaining close coordination and cooperation, friendship, partnership with South Korea.
Okay, thank you very much.